What's up, guys? I'm Fabio Salas, and welcome to the Living Mad Channel, where we talk all about the American dream. So I'm somebody that likes to talk about real estate a lot. Anybody who's worked with me for the last 10 years or so knows that I invest in real estate and I talk about it a lot, especially with my Marines, because I want them to learn about it and I want them to hopefully get involved in real estate investing. So with that in mind, me working at the University of Illinois now, this is something that I want my students to learn about. And I know that I'm not gonna be able to teach them everything. They're gonna have to learn a lot of it on their own. But I want them to give them just a little bit of what I've learned along the way that can hopefully help them start it as they graduate college and go on to start their own military careers. So it's gonna be a couple videos. I'm not gonna put it all into one video, so you can take it in little chunks. But today, the first thing I wanna talk to you about is the four ways that a rental property can make you money. A lot of people think you buy a house, if the mortgage is 1500 bucks, you rent it out for 1500 bucks, you're set. But there's actually a lot more to it. And because of that, because people don't understand everything that goes into it, sometimes they get in trouble. I've had a lot of friends, a lot of Marines that I've worked with, who have bought houses, get moved to a different state, rent out their house, and end up either having to sell the house at a loss, losing it in bankruptcy or a short sale, just bad news overall. And that's because they weren't prepared for what it means to be a homeowner. Well, not so much a homeowner, but a real estate investor, a landlord who rents out properties. Once you understand how the whole business works, it's a lot easier to make decisions about what kind of house to buy, what neighborhoods to look at, how to really invest your money in real estate so that it makes you money in the long run. So that's what I want to start with today, is the four ways that a house makes you money, or a rental property makes you money. Now, hopefully you've been watching some of my other videos. Some of them are about money, some are not. I hope you like them. I hope you're getting something out of it. If you do, I encourage you to hit that like button so the YouTube world knows that these are good videos for you to watch. All right, so the first thing, the first way that a house can make you money is called cash flow. Cash flow is nothing more than the money that's left over after you've paid all the expenses of owning a rental property. Now, I gave the example of you have a house, mortgage is $1,500, you rent it out for $1,500. You might think you're breaking even, but that's not the case, because there's a lot of other things that go into it when it comes to being a landlord. You gotta pay taxes on it. There's gonna be repairs that are gonna happen. You may not have a repair every single month, but at some point, the toilet's gonna break. Maybe a drain's gonna clog up. Maybe the garage door won't open. Maybe it's a roof problem and you gotta spend $10,000 to $15,000. It's a lot of money to put into a house that you're not living in. If you don't think about all these things, if you don't plan for those things, you're gonna be in a lot of trouble when those repairs come around, especially if you don't have savings. People don't think about vacancies until they have a vacancy. So if your house is vacant for a month, 2 months, God forbid 3 months, you're gonna have to pay that mortgage out of pocket. If you're not ready, if you're not planning for that, if you're not thinking about that before you buy the house, you're gonna find yourself in trouble. If you buy, maybe you find your dream home, beautiful house, super cheap, awesome, but you know you're only gonna be there for, I don't know, 2 to 5 years, and then you're gonna make it a rental. Well, if it's a market where people don't really wanna rent because maybe your house is too expensive for the area, or maybe the neighborhood is mostly homeowners, not too many renters, if you don't really look at the market, you're gonna end up with a house that's beautiful, it's gorgeous, but nobody wants to rent it. And now you're stuck with it. And now you gotta figure out what else to do with it. So when we think about cash flow, you gotta think about vacancies. You gotta think about small repairs, large repairs, taxes. Maybe you got a property manager that you gotta pay to manage your property. Maybe you don't need one if you live in the same city and you wanna do it yourself. But if you live in a different city, overseas, whatever the case may be, you might wanna do that. And maybe you do live in the same city, but you have a very busy job. Or, you know, you'd rather spend your time hanging out with family or doing other things than dealing with tenants. So you gotta pay a property manager. Again, those are all expenses that add up very fast. I would say, well, not I would say, the experts say that at least 50% of the monthly rent should go towards those general expenses. And I'm not talking PITI, which is principal, interest, taxes, and insurance. I'm talking just everything else, repairs, property manager, vacancies, all of those things. Now you gotta add in the mortgage, which usually includes everything, right? So you'll have your principal, which pays down the actual balance of the loan, the interest, which is what the bank makes from giving you a loan, the taxes, which is what the state, charges you for owning property in that state, and the insurance, which is what's gonna save you if the house burns down or something bad happens to the house. You gotta add all that stuff up. Once you add it all up, you might find that you're getting the $1,000 rent, but only $100 cash flow. And again, that depends on the market. It depends on how much you bought the house for, how much you're renting it for. You gotta crunch all the numbers. But at the end of the day, don't think that cash flow is just, oh, I paid the mortgage and I have $300 left. That's cash flow. No, a lot of that's gonna go towards expenses that you're gonna have later on. You're not gonna have them every month, but you're gonna have them at some point. So you've gotta set money aside for those things. So cash flow is one way to make money off a rental property. In the Midwest, I'm in Illinois right now, it's very easy to buy houses for cash flow because you can buy a house for $70,000 here and rent it out for $1,000 a month. You're gonna make anywhere between $100 to $150 a month from that property if you put, say, 20% down. If you're in California, where I was stationed last, very difficult to get cash flow there. You're gonna buy a house, same house that you'd buy here for $70,000, you'll buy it in California for $600,000. But now you're only renting it for anywhere around $3,200, $3,500 a month, which is probably just enough to cover the mortgage. You still gotta come up with money for the property manager, repairs, vacancies, all those things. So you're not necessarily gonna make cash flow out there. So there's different markets, and that doesn't mean that people just wanna invest in the Midwest because they want cash flow. There are people investing in California, me being one of them, who are not looking for that cash flow. But you need to understand, different markets give you different things. Some places give you cash flow, some don't. So why would somebody invest in California where there's less of a chance to get cash flow, like I did? Well, that's because another way to make money off of a property is appreciation. Appreciation is nothing more than the value of your house going up. If you buy it for $500,000 and it goes up to $600,000, well, that property appreciated $100,000. If that happens in 3 years, you've made $100,000 raise or net worth raise for that property in 3 years. If it takes you 20 years for it to go up $100,000, well, that's not as great. So again, different markets are gonna have different levels of appreciation. One thing to keep in mind is you should never invest in real estate with just appreciation in mind. Now, California, New York, some parts of Chicago, Atlanta, those are great cities for appreciation historically, but just like the index funds and stock market, you should never invest solely based off of historical circumstances. So just because San Diego has appreciated about 3.5% annually for the last 50 years, we think, well, that's great, that's awesome, compared to the rest of the U.S. that has appreciated anywhere between 1.5% to 2%, depending on what part of the country. It's a big deal. 1.5% to 2% difference is a big deal, especially if you're talking about a $500,000 property, $1 million property. 1% of $1 million property is what? $10,000. So if you go up just 1% every year on a property, but it's $1 million, you're going up 10 grand. So if you're in San Diego, you buy that $1 million property, but it appreciates 3.5%, well, now you've made $35,000 in 1 year. Whereas in the Midwest, maybe you buy a house that's worth $100,000 and it appreciates 2%. Well, now you've only made $2,000 in that same year. So appreciation is one thing to consider, but don't always bank on it. Don't buy a house thinking it's gonna appreciate, because we don't know the future. San Diego has, and other cities in California, San Francisco, Los Angeles, have appreciated immensely in the last 10 years since the real estate market crashed. And overall, it's appreciated immensely in the last 50 years, but we don't know what's gonna happen in the future. People say there's gonna be an earthquake that's gonna take California down. Who knows? I don't know, I'm sure nobody really knows. But if that were to happen, all those houses are going down, there goes your appreciation. So it's good to know about it, it's good to consider it, but don't make it your number one goal. So cash flow, appreciation. The third one that you need to know about is the tax benefits, guys. Tax benefits, because owning a house as a landlord is not the same as owning a house as a homeowner. If you live in a house and it's your primary residence, you get tax benefits for it. but you get a lot more tax benefits for owning a house as a landlord. And that's because if you're a landlord, that's almost considered a business. Well, not almost, it basically is a business. That is income that's coming to you from somebody else, from a tenant. And it's sort of like that tenant is your employee because they're giving you money every month. And that house is your little business. So the more houses you have, the more little businesses you have making you money. Now, let's say that you live in a house, your primary residence, and you got to replace the roof. And let's just say it's $10,000. Well, that's $10,000 that you got to come out of pocket, pay to get that roof fixed, and that's it. That's all you get. But if you're a landlord and the tenant reports a claim because there's a roof leaking and you got to replace the roof, you'll still have to pay the $10,000. But at the end of the year, when you file your taxes, that $10,000, you can write those off because you're a landlord. And again, depending on the state, how much you can write off, how much you'll get back, it's gonna depend on the state taxes, the state laws, but it's a tax write-off. What it does is it reduces your taxable income. So if you made from your 9-to-5 job, if you made $100,000 for that year, the $10,000 that you spent on that rental property, you can put those against your income. Now you have $10,000 less that are gonna be taxed on your taxable income. So that's another huge benefit to owning a property as a rental. And it's not just repairs, it's anything that has to do with running that property. So if you pay a property manager, if you have to do landscaping on it, if you have to do fumigating, maybe pool maintenance if your rental has a pool, don't recommend it. Cost a lot to insure a pool as a landlord, but maybe you have a house with a pool that you want to rent out. So whatever you're having to pay for as a landlord, including the taxes and insurance that you pay for this house, can all be used to reduce your taxable income. So that's a huge benefit to being a landlord versus being a homeowner of your own house. So we've talked about cash flow, we talked about appreciation, and we talked about tax benefits. The fourth way that a rental property can make you money is through the equity buildup. So let's say that you buy a house for $100,000. If you rent it out, somebody else is paying that balance for you. Somebody else is paying that loan for you. Now, maybe you rent it for $1,000 a month, and out of that, for the first year, maybe only $100, $150 are going toward the principal. Not a whole lot, I get it. Over time, how much goes toward the principal grows. So by year 10, it might be $400 a month out of that $1,000. Just because the bank will charge a lot of interest the first 7 years or so of the loan. Regardless of how much it is, that's not you that's making the payments. That's somebody else. That's somebody else who is paying down the loan. And because of that, every single year, every single month, your net worth is going up a little bit more each time without you having to work, without you having to do anything. And again, this is keeping in mind that you bought the right property, right market, have rented out for the right price, so that you're not having to put any of your money into this property every single month. If all that is done correctly, now your net worth is going up every single month, a little bit more each time. The more properties you buy, the more your net worth is going up. If you're a 22-year-old fresh out of college, you buy your first house at 22, and you do that every 2 years till you're 30, by the time you're 30, you've got 5 houses. Now with 5 houses, you're not, you know, no real estate magnet by any means, but you've accumulated some passive cash flow, some passive income that's coming into you every single month, whether it's your net worth or your bank account if you've got cash flow, without you having to do anything. And you're already gonna be way ahead of your peers, way ahead of most people in general. So those are the four ways that you can make money from a rental property. Again, cash flow, appreciation, tax benefits, and the equity buildup, the loan pay down. If you understand those four and you learned how to make those work for you in different markets, whether it's a market that's big on appreciation, not so much for cash flow, or one that's big on cash flow, not so much for appreciation, maybe one that's a little bit balanced like Texas. If you learn how to work these four things, you will be way ahead of most people. And you will be on your way to building a net worth that's actually gonna help you retire. And I'm not saying retire at 65 because that's easy. Retiring at 65 is easy. Not everybody makes it because they don't think about it ahead of time. So we'll talk about that in another video. But 65 is easy. What I want to help you with is figure out how to retire early. Not necessarily because you want to stop working, but so that you can pursue other options. Whether you want to go work overseas, or maybe you just want to do volunteer work, or maybe you do want to retire and just spend time with your kids before they're grown and old. Whatever the case may be, I want you to get to a point where you have complete financial freedom, where you can choose, do I want to keep working or not? Do I want to change career fields completely and take a 50% pay cut, but I know that I'm going to enjoy the job, yes or no? So figure out these four ways, and I guarantee you, you'll be on your way. All right, guys. Hopefully you got something out of this. I think this is very beneficial. I wish I would have known this when I first got into real estate at 22. I didn't know what I was doing, made a lot of mistakes, lost a lot of money. But hopefully you got something out of it so you don't make the same mistakes that I did. If you did, and you think this is something other people should know, other people can learn from, hit that like button, hit that subscribe button so you know when I upload more videos and other people know that we're checking out good content here. All right, guys, keep living mad, and I'll see you in the next video.